I didn't get to say this last week, so I get to say it. Welcome to Second Baptist Church. I am glad that you're here. Hey, this evening at 4:30, we're going to meet in this room, right here in this room at 4:30. We'll have a short worship time together. By 5 o'clock, we'll be across the way getting ready to eat. So potluck dinner, make sure you bring your stuff and be ready to be in this room at 4:30. And we'll share just a nice time of preparation until I get the clue that says, yeah, it's time to go. And, of course, being a good Baptist, I'll shut up so we can go eat. That's tonight. Be here in this room at 4:30, and we'll do that. If you want to buy a poinsettia in memory of somebody, the papers are right in the front pew here. They look just like this. You need those today. So if you want to do that, take care of that. And they are, I don't know, $7. They're $7 a piece. Just put that in the offering receptacles and mark it poinsettia or flower or Christmas flower. If you can't spell poinsettia, just put a great big P. And then we'll give it to the pastor. We won't do that. So take care of that and know that. And then Tuesday morning, if you can come at about 9 o'clock and help to decorate this room to get it prepared for next Sunday, which will be Hanging of Green. And it's going to be a great service. A lot of folks are going to be involved in it. So when you come next Sunday, the room's going to already be almost finished decorating. We'll finish decorating during the service for our Advent and Christmas season. Looking forward to that. It's going to be a great time. I'm excited about that. So I need to quit talking, and we need to start doing some singing. Y'all ready to do some singing together? Y'all always sing so good. I love to hear you sing. Brother Carl is helping us. Renee is home, not feeling too good today, so we'll keep praying for her as well. And it's good today on stage, it appears, except for the women. No, y'all got us outnumbered. Full house, 3-2. Right? So, okay. Let's sing something together.
If you're here in San Francisco, we're going to make a joyful noise unto the Lord.
There we go.
Well, we have our blessings that just God gives us every day. It's a blessing being here. If you stay with us as we sing Count Your Blessings today.
Sing, 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 sing
day, God blessing everything we're doing.
By thy
something in particular, someone in particular. Just come and help us while we say to God, I say this a lot, but I want you to understand it. When we pray, we're not saying, God, please, please do this, do this, do this. Yeah, we're saying that. But we're mostly saying, God, I trust you with this, and I leave it there. Join me while we pray today. Father, thank you that we can trust you. And that we have so many things to thank you about, but that's so huge because we can trust you for salvation. Many people don't know about that. And we pray for them, Father, we pray for lost people today who have never trusted you for their eternity. I pray, God, that you would move in their life and move toward them and reach them again with the gospel and help them to hear and understand and receive and respond. So they trust you with the gospel. And Father, we can trust you with our lives. You take care of us every day. You provide our every need. You said you would, and you do. And maybe not lavishly, like some people are confused and think that you said you do. But Father, so wonderfully, we can look to you and say, you've met my need today. And we thank you for that. You take care of our bodies. You give us health. You restore us to health. You provided for us the ability to see things that some years ago might have been an immediate death sentence, and now we can have knowledge and the skill for the doctors to prepare. And sometimes, Father, you just take it away and clean it up. And we thank you that we can trust you with our bodies and with our homes, with our jobs. Father, that everything in our lives, we lay it before you. And if we're doing like we should, and it's hard sometimes, Father, help us with the hard stuff. We say, it's all yours. Show us what to do with it. And then we just do that. Because that's what faith is all about. And so in this prayer, Father, we express this morning our faith toward you. Our willingness to understand that what you say is what is true. And that we can count on it. And that our lives are different because of what you said and what you've done. And as you give blessing to us and you repair broken bodies and you repair broken homes and you provide for needs in our lives and mostly you provided Jesus for our salvation, Father, today we give you thanks for everything, for all that you do, mostly for who you are. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Next hymn, it's called I'd Love to Tell the Story, but I'd like to call it I'd Love to Tell the Truth of the Story that changes lives, that changes. I see kids every day, my students will tell you that I love interacting with them. I love telling the story that changes lives and brings them hope. So this is
to be my demon.
as he comes, every time a heart comes in, God accepts it, no matter what the past. And the person is changed. And it's just a great story, great faithfulness from God.
Thank you.
Chapter 17, Luke 17, and we'll begin in verse number 11. It's a familiar story to many folks, and it's just so pointed for us at this time of year, especially, and I got to begin here, especially here in the United States of America, when the poorest of the poor, compared to many places, dare I say even most places around this globe, even the poorest of the poor in this culture were rich. Were rich. I know that there are some very poor people in our culture, but I've seen this firsthand. And especially in this culture, we need to remember this. And now at the time of the year when we think about Thanksgiving, here's the story as it reads in Scripture, Luke chapter 17, beginning in verse 11. God's Word says, "Now it happened, as Jesus went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered a certain village, there met him 10 men who were lepers, who stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, 'Jesus, Master, have mercy on us.' And so when Jesus saw them, he said to them, 'Go show yourselves to the priest.' And so it was that as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, returned with a loud voice and glorified God and fell down on his face at Jesus' feet and gave him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. So Jesus answered and said, 'Well, were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? Were there not any found who returned to give glory to God except this foreigner?' Jesus said, 'Arise and go your way. Your faith has made you well.'" And may God add his blessing to the reading, to the hearing of his word. What an indictment against us is this story in the life of Jesus. We could talk a lot about the history and the geography of all of this. When he went through the midst of Samaria and Galilee, there's a point to that actually being there, because many people, when they were traveling to make their pilgrimages to Jerusalem, would bypass Samaria. They just don't want to go there. The Samaritan people were just not the folks that they wanted to be around. Racist is what it was, okay? They had it back then, and it's still today. And if we continue to try to fight the battle of racism instead of fighting the battle of lostness, then there's a lot of people going to go to hell who have become less worried about racism. We got to tell people about Jesus, folks. Jesus went to the place where most people went through, mostly probably because it was the most expedient route. And so through Samaria and through Galilee, he went on his way to Jerusalem. And we noticed that Jesus came to where these men were. And I want you to grab that real quick. Jesus came to where the people who need the blessing of God are. In this case, he went right through Samaria, where he wasn't supposed to be. But in our case, we can take it even a step grander than this, and maybe a little less specific, but certainly in a grander scale, and say this. Jesus, are you ready? Set aside some of the glory of being God and put on a bag of flesh and came from the throne room of God Almighty to this earth to walk among us. I'm telling you, Jesus has come, and he came to seek and to save that which was lost. That's why he ventured through Samaria that day, because there were lost people there. That's why he ventured through Galilee that day, because lost people needed to know about the Messiah who has come. Are we understanding that Jesus came not just so he could be here and, oh, everybody knows the name of Jesus now, not to build popularity or fame for himself, but he came to be where lost people are, where hurting people are, where sick people are, where dying people are, where people without him will go to hell are, and he came to where they are. Jesus came. We're going to really jump on that theme beginning next Sunday as we talk about the Advent season of Jesus. The word Advent means coming, right? And we get into the season of the Advent of Jesus Christ, his coming, and why he came. But listen, we in Thanksgiving season, one of the things we need to thank him for above all else is that Jesus came. And we just sang the song. Jesus paid it all. His payment was part of why he came, so that you and I can have eternal life. He paid a debt that was not his, so that we could have eternal life that we had already thrown away and lost. Isn't that awesome? So, sorry. So Jesus, it happened that Jesus went to Jerusalem and passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. If you look at that on a map, you're going to see Galilee comes before Samaria on the way to Jerusalem. And you can just look and see that. They are both cities and regions, and you can see that and see how the geography of it all comes together. But then he came to this place. And we assume, because the story ends up telling us that the man was a Samaritan, that this happened while he was in Samaria. But he entered a certain village. When we think of a village, we think of a little place with a few huts sitting around and a bonfire and a village chief and all of that probably. But in the village, that was a small town. And this small town where he was had some people there who were lepers. In fact, there were 10 of them that met Jesus, and they stood afar off. Now, if you go to the book of Leviticus and you begin to read the law that Moses brought, especially concerning leprosy, there are some very specific things given about leprosy. One of them is that you could not get very close to people. And as you were approaching where people are, you had to call out your condition. And here's what your condition is. Unclean! Unclean! You're walking. Unclean! Unclean! So just in case somebody happens to be hiding behind a rock that you're about to walk by, they will hear you calling as you walk, unclean! Because you had to go do stuff. You had to go find some food, and you had to get from place to place, and so, but while you walk, unclean! Unclean! Because leprosy was a very terrible, terrible thing. I mean, it's very treatable today. Most cases, those who get leprosy today receive ointments and pills, and they're fine. There are scars that are left on their body, but leprosy can affect any part of your body. Mostly what it does is it kills your nerves and messes with the way your sense of feel and touch happens. And so what happens is you get the effects of it, let's say, in your foot, and then your foot is numb, and you're walking along, and you stub your toe on a big rock. Well, you know you did because you stumbled and fell, but you didn't hurt because your foot was numb, but your foot got all messed up and cut open and everything, and then it got infected and all that, and then you lose your foot. And usually in that day, in Jesus' day, an infection of that caliber would take your life. So they didn't want to spread that thing. They didn't want to deal with that. And they had some salves and some treatments for it, but they 2,000 years ago, it just wasn't real effective. But what was effective was to walk around unclean. I'm unclean. Don't come near me. I'm unclean. If you come near me, what I have will spread to you. Unclean. You don't want to get this leprosy stuff. Unclean. The guy's walking around with various degrees of infection and really nastiness going on in their body and just some really gross stuff happening. And then you don't want to know, but some people who have leprosy, you just can't tell. Much like disabilities that we hear about today, they call them hidden disabilities. You can't see them. Maybe they could wear their clothes just so that you couldn't see that they had leprosy. Maybe it hadn't affected them so deeply that it's not real visible, but they still had to call it out. Unclean, unclean. So they stood afar off. They weren't allowed to get close to people, because it was considered in that day that for them to get close to you could be a death sentence. And as they stood afar off, they recognized Jesus. Can I just make a little application of that? When people stand afar off, which many people do from you and from me every single day, when they stand afar off, what do they see about us that is recognizable? What do people recognize from way far away when they look at you? Do they see an honest person? Do they see a kind person? Do they see an angry person? Do they see a gossipy person? Do they see a stingy person? Do they see a generous person? Do they see a helpful person or a harmful person? Do they see a caring person or a selfish person? What do they see when they see you? And at the top of that list of what people see, I would ask, do they see Jesus? Just a little more clearly, because they have seen you. These men stood afar off. And those two little words, afar off, really sometimes we just kind of blow past them because we don't think about it. But the law required them to stand afar off. The religious law required that they stay back and announce themselves. And so they announced themselves. They were unclean, unclean. But these 10 men who stood far off saw Jesus, and they recognized something even more significant when they saw Jesus. And that was that Jesus had the power to heal them. And so they called out, and they said, Jesus, verse 13, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Unclean, unclean, Jesus, Jesus. Let me say this to you. Jesus didn't come to be far away from us. He didn't come so that we could stand far, far away from him and have to call out to him, oh, please help. And it seems sometimes that he is so far away, but I promise you that no matter how far away from Jesus you walk, the turnaround trip is only one step. I wish I was original to that statement because it's so good. Read that online someplace. The turnaround trip, just one step. And they got within voice distance because that was all that they were allowed. And there's a lot of people in this world today who are not allowed, they think, to come to this church. I was visiting with someone who lives very close to this church in this very neighborhood. And this person has what we would call in our church a sin issue in their life. A very notable and definable and visible issue with sin. And as I spoke with this girl and visited with her before she knew that I'm Pastor Steve from Second Baptist Church, as I visited with her and talked with her, and I said, hey, where'd you go to church? Oh, I don't go to church. Well, you got a church right there. Oh, those people don't want me there. They said that about this church. Nobody in this church has ever told her that I know of. Oh, did they tell you that? No, I just know it. How does she know it? Because there is a very visible and significant sin issue in her life. She doesn't try to hide it. She lives it, and that's what she wants to do and who she wants to be. But she knows that there is disapproval about that sin issue here. Now, some people say, oh, no, we can't have disapproval of sin. We disapprove of sin. At Second Baptist Church, we disapprove of what God disapproves of. And because God disapproves of it is the reason we disapprove of it. But listen, I don't ever want folks to think we disapprove of them. They're going to. It's called natural normal. It's the way people think. It's what sin does to you. Sin makes you feel unwelcome in the presence of God. That's what it does. Just like sin made you feel unwelcome in the presence of your parents, right? You know what I'm talking about, don't you? When you were a kid and you did it wrong, you didn't want to go get around mom and dad. Because mom and dad are new. And when mom came in and said, did you do such and so? Hopefully you weren't so foolish as to say, well, no. Because the very fact that mom's asking you means that she already knows you did it. You know? So you don't want to be around mom. Because whatever kind of way that mom's going to get you, mom's going to get you. Because you did it. And sinful people feel that way about the church and about God. They think that we're out here to tear them up and to tell them how bad and terrible and wrong they are. And yes, we will address sin issues. And yes, we'll talk about them. And yes, we're going to call the things that God calls bad and terrible and sinful. We're going to call them that. And if one's identity is built up in that particular sin thing, okay, if they're a drug addict and the only thing that they can think about themselves as is a drug addict, and we start talking that addiction to drugs, especially illicit drugs that you don't need for health reasons and things like that, that's a sin. And we need to get off those drugs. We need to work our way through that. And there's processes to do that and help you do that kind of thing and all that. But see, their identity is as a drug addict. So when we address the sin, they feel like that we're addressing them. That's the problem. That's why people feel far off. I can't get close to God. I can't get close to God's people because I identify as a sinner in God's sight. They know this thing that I am, this thing that I do, is a sin. And God doesn't like that. And so I must not be welcome. And in this particular case, this particular person said at that church, pointing to this very building, broke my heart. And when I said, well, let me tell you something, and I identified who I was, I'm the pastor of that church right there. And if you walk through the doors of that church and you're not welcome, you come see me, and I'll make somebody else feel very unwelcome. Can I just be that plain spoken? If you make somebody who needs to get right with the Lord feel unwelcome for coming to this hospital for sinners, go someplace else. You know what I mean? I'm not trying to get anybody to go. I don't want you to leave. Because you're that person who needs to be here too, this hospital for sinners. Because we're not here due to the fact that we're perfect, are we? And I keep reading these things online. I wish this was original to me too. I'm here because I need the grace of God to heal my soul and to make me into what He wants me to be. Not because I've already arrived. I don't get to stand in the pulpit because I'm perfect. Because those of you that have known me for 10 years and some of you who've known me for longer, no, I'm not. Good, nobody's sitting in. Thank you very much for that lack of response. But we're not. We're just folks that God's working on and building. It's a process known as sanctification, where God builds us up and builds us up and builds us up until the time that we get to be glorified, that glorification. And that'll happen when we're in the very presence of God in His throne room and we hear, well done, good and faithful servant. We're absent from this body that is tainted with sin. We're absent from this world that is tainted with sin. And we're standing in His presence and receiving His glory and His honor. Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into my rest. And it's going to be a different day, in a different body, a different place. And until then, we're all dirty, rotten sinners still working on a relationship with God who need His help every single day. And everybody needs to be welcome to come to the doors. So don't you make, I mean, you can't come in here because you stink. You can't come in here because you're gay. you can't come in here because you do drugs. You can't come in here because you got a bad mouth. You can't come in here because. And to most people who would say that, I would say to you, you can't come in here because you're bitter. You can't come in here because you gossip. You can't come in here because you judge. You can't come in here because you're ugly toward people and don't spread the love of Christ. I could say the same stuff to the people who would say that to people. We need to go out to people and say, God loves you enough to want you to be a part of a church, a part of a group where you can be loved. And if there are things that are not right according to Scripture in your life, let's walk through that. But you're not going to be thrown out the door the first time you walk in because you've got problems, or not a one of us will be sitting in this room right. Well, I look out, I see one of you. I won't say which one. Who could come? But the rest of us, we'd all be gone, right? And everybody goes, is it me? Is it me? I'm not telling. Well, these 10 men, they were lepers. They had a real serious issue in their life that the law of God required them to announce and proclaim everywhere they went. Unclean! Unclean! And they lifted up their voices, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. They knew where to go, just like unclean people who are not saved know where to go. They know we've got to go to God and get this thing dealt with. They just don't know how. And they don't really know that God will accept them. They don't really know that just like us, we will be received and blessed. And by confessing our sin, we will be cleansed of all unrighteousness and forgiven, even though God knows that some of it's going to continue in our life. Isn't he a good God? I'm thankful to him for that. Well, Jesus then took them to the law. Verse number 14 is a statement concerning the law. Jesus said to these 10 men who yelled out, unclean, Jesus, he said, go and show yourself to the priest. Because only the priest could say to these unclean men who were socially and spiritually unclean, they weren't allowed to get near society, and the only way to do that is to go to a priest. Have a priest examine you, medical examination, in fact, to see if your leprosy was still present, and if your leprosy was gone, he could proclaim you cleansed and have you walk through the rituals and do the things, and then you could go and be a part of society again. Jesus said, go show yourself to the priests so that you can be known by society that God has done a wonderful thing in your life and taken you from being unclean, unclean, everywhere you go, unclean, to being cleansed by the power of God. You know what I would say to that? You need to go and show yourself. You need to go and show yourself to the people. The scars of the sin may still be there, just like the scars of the leprosy might be there. I have a photograph. I wish I had brought it today. That has my hands laying on a table, and then a man with leprosy, his hands beside my hands. And he was healed from the leprosy. He was on some medication that keeps it. And his hands were all spotted and bumpy. You know how ostrich skin is kind of bumpy, kind of? And it was there. And the difference between his hands that were slightly withered and all that, he was clean of his leprosy. He was no longer contagious, but he still had the scars. Can I remind you that sin leaves scars? And even though God has forgiven us and cleansed us from all unrighteousness, we still bear the scars of our sin and we'll carry them. And that's still part of what it is. But when we go to the priest, he can say, in spite of your scars, you are clean. You can go and you can be a part of society again. You don't have to walk around anymore yelling at the top of your lungs and staying a distance away from people, unclean, unclean. Now you can go and interact with people. Now you can go and be a part of that society that's there. So Jesus said, according to the law, this is what you do. So go show yourself to the priest. Jesus communicated. You know, when Jesus came, he came to seek and save that which was lost. And what he did while he was here is he communicated his love to us with truth, with the law in mind. Well, the law, that's all Old Testament stuff. It doesn't matter anymore. And if you understand how the law and the three parts of the law and all of that come together, there's some of that law that still does affect us today, that we're still supposed to concern ourselves with today. And when we obey that law that Jesus completed, he fulfilled all of the ceremonial law. He represented all of the moral law and lived within all of the civil law, the three parts of the law of Moses that he gave, that you can read about in Leviticus and Numbers and Deuteronomy. he lived with all of that, so that now he is the high priest, and we go show our sin to him, and he proclaims us clean. Isn't that great? And so what he's saying to them is, I want you to go to the priest, because that is a foreshadowing, it is a picture of what I'm going to do for you and who you're going to be, because you're clean. I'm very sorry. Y'all know it's allergy time. It's just what it is. And so when Jesus saw them, he communicated to them, go and be sure the law is fulfilled in your life. And that's what I would say to you. Be sure the law is fulfilled in your life. See, Jesus fulfilled the law. And so if we put our faith in Jesus, the law is fulfilled in our life because of the one in whom our faith has been placed. Right? It's not because, again, we do it all right, because we don't do everything perfectly and properly. It's because Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. That sin that left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Go show yourself to the priest. That great high priest we have that Hebrews tells us about, whose name is Jesus. And he communicated that. Not only that, but and so it was in the middle of 14, and so it was that as they went, they were cleansed. Jesus not only came, he not only communicated, but he cleaned them up. Just like 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He's going to clean us up. You know, see, I got to get all cleaned up. I got to stop doing this bad stuff before I come to church. I can't come to church. That's from the devil, and he's put that lie out there, and so many people believe it. I got to get all cleaned up before I come to church. Let me tell you something. You ain't got enough in you to clean you up. You need Jesus to help you clean up. And he's got everything necessary to clean you up. And I can't explain how people who he's cleaned up and who he's forgiven of their sin and cleansed from all unrighteousness still have some outpouring of unrighteous moments in their life. I really can't explain that. Some people say, well, you're sinning again, so you just lost your salvation. And I dare you to show me that in the Bible. That's just not there. I double dog dare you to show me that in the Bible. In fact, if you can lose your salvation, see, the Bible makes it very clear how to be saved. The Bible doesn't anywhere say how to be unsaved. And God, if he left that possibility open, don't you just think he'd tell us how to do it so we could avoid that? But he never said how. How much, well, you sin again. How much sin? Is just the thought of sin enough? Do I got to go out and, how about a little bitty thing that affects nobody? How about if I drive 1 mile over the speed limit? That's a sin. I've broken the law. How about that? Am I lost again? You know, I mean, listen. I know I'm not. You know you're not. But there's people out there that think that they're lost again. They got to get saved every Sunday. Thank God for grace. Amen. The grace that carries on whole life long. Grace that is greater than all my sin. Thank God for that grace. He said, listen, here you go. As they went, they were cleansed. He cleaned them up. And as they noticed, hey, we're cleansed. I can feel my foot walking on the path now. That infection that was in my eye that caused my right eye not to be able to see, it's gone. Hey, did you notice you're swinging your arm when you're walking? Oh, you weren't doing that before. All of a sudden, they were clean, and they noticed it, and they began to keep walking toward the priest, except one of them. And one of them turned around, verse 15 says, one of them, when he saw that he was healed, returned. He didn't bother going to the priest. He could do that any old time. But he wanted to get to where Jesus was before Jesus went on into Jerusalem where he was headed. And so he returned, and with a loud voice, he gave glory to God. He fell down on his face at the feet of Jesus and gave thanks to Jesus. And then this phrase. This racist phrase. You know there's racism in the Bible. Just because it's in the Bible doesn't mean God approves of it, right? There's a lot of murders in the Bible. I don't think anybody would say God approves of murder, right? But they're racism, and here it is. And he was a Samaritan. He was one of those people of mixed blood who has Jewish blood in him and other blood in him, and that's all it takes to be a Samaritan. They lived in Samaria. They had changed their own thing. They have their own place to worship. They have their own way and their understanding of the law. And they have perverted everything about God. But I'm going to tell you this. in the midst of their sinfulness and perverting all of the stuff that God had done in order to preserve a line to bring a Messiah to us, this one recognized where the power was. The power was in Jesus, and he didn't go to no priest. He went to the purveyor of all priesthood. He went to the high priest, who is Jesus Christ. He went back to Jesus, and he proclaimed with a loud voice, falling on his face, giving glory to God. I want to say thank you to that doctor that did surgery on my wife last Sunday. He did a fine job. And that nurse that we had there in the recovery room, oh, she was just sweet, and we just talked. The only surgery that happened was hers. And we were in there. Nobody else was there. And we were in there. And that nurse, she was just so kind and brought everything. When they brought her a cup of ice chips, you know what? They brought me one too. Wasn't that nice? Well, one night we're sitting in the hospital, and that nurse, she brought, we went her liquid diet, you know, that stuff, that, I don't know what it is, and that she could have. She brought me a whole plate of food, too. Had that meatloaf stuff that you liked so much the other day when you were in the hospital. The good stuff. And they just took, so I want to go back and I want to say thank you to them. In fact, they were working really hard and diligently, and they were agents of the healing that's taking place in my life right now. But I'm going to tell you this. We say thank you to every doctor and every nurse and every clinician and every person that worked in the laboratory. And I'm grateful to all of them for being able to recognize the people who took the pictures and the images and all of those kind of things. We say thank you to all of them, but miss giving thanks to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We miss the one who did the healing. Isn't he awesome? See, he came to do stuff like that. Sometimes it's like done, healed. Right here in the Word of God. We read it. Go show yourself to the priest. They began to walk in. They were cleansed. Sometimes it's through medical processes. Sometimes it's just through letting the sickness take its course. Sometimes there are just so many ways that God heals. And I think that God uses all of these things as ways to heal. But here's the point of the thing. It wasn't that he was healed. Instead, he brought back glory to God and praise and honor to God, even though he wasn't of the race of people who were supposed to do that. He was a Samaritan. He was one of those people who were not welcome at the temple. He was one of those people who were not welcome in the local synagogues. He was one of those people who could bring a sacrifice, but they had to give the sacrifice to people outside the temple for it to be carried in. Eventually, there was a court of the Gentiles put in place so that they could come in a little bit, but they couldn't come all the way in. Somebody else had to present stuff because they just weren't worthy. Not just because he was a leper, but also because he was a Samaritan. But it was that Samaritan that came back to Jesus. You know what that tells me? Anybody can come. He had two strikes against him already. He was a leper. He was unclean. He was a Samaritan. He was of unclean blood to begin with. He was the wrong race in that particular day and time. Two strikes against him in that day and in that culture, yet he had, you can have two strikes and still get a home run. You know that, don't you? Mm-hmm. And he got a home run that day. He got a better home run than the other guys. The other guys just got healed. That guy came back to Jesus. And he came back and he gave thanks and he gave glory. And Jesus kind of reminded him of how important it was and what he was doing. Verse 17, were there not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Where are they at now? You just go on and go your way. Your faith has made you well. Jesus not only came, he not only communicated, he not only cleaned him up, but after all of those things, he commended the man and commissioned him to go his way. Told him how to live. Keep giving glory to God. That's kind of the process that we look at. You know, we look at this and it's a great big thing, and we've got a man who's a Samaritan and a man, so he's a traitor by his own blood, and then we've got a man who is leprous, which is carried around the body through the blood, and so his blood is all wrong. But that day, he met the one whose blood would change the lives of everyone who would call him. His name is Jesus. I wonder, have you met him? Not have you seen him just from afar off. Because from afar off, you can call on his name and he will respond to you and he will meet your needs from afar off. But have you ever come? Listen to these words. He returned with a loud voice, glorified God, and fell down on his face at Jesus' feet. He wasn't so many feet away from him. Unclean, unclean. He hadn't been to the priest and had the religious institution of the day proclaimed that he was okay to be a part of society now, but he knew that he was ready to come to Jesus. And he fell at Jesus' feet. Even when the religious establishment had not given him the okay to be at anybody's feet. But he gave his glory to God at the feet of Jesus. Have you been there? All the ugly stuff that happens to you in your life, you can sit and wallow in it all day long. But until you come to Jesus, things are going to just stay the same. As long as you keep rehearsing your pain, oh, he hurt me so bad, and that's why I'm so angry with him. You're going to stay angry with him. Oh, I had this sickness a long time ago, and it made me where I can't get up and can't walk around. A lot of people had that same sickness and got up and walked around. Because they didn't keep living in the sickness. They decided they were going to get up and walk around. A lot of folks, some folks never do. That's part of it too. But are you going to the right place when it's time to get ready? He still had to go to the priest. Because until the priest proclaimed him to be able to get into society, until the priest proclaimed him to be cleansed, he couldn't yet get with society. But that was an after thing. First he went to the one who cleansed him before he went to the one who could see that he was cleansed. Have you been to Jesus? That's where it all comes down, isn't it? Thanksgiving time. He came to Jesus to give him thanks. Were there not 10? Where's the other 9 who can come and give thanks? But there was just the one. He said, not any found who returned to give glory to God except this foreigner. Just this foreigner. Your faith has made you well. And I promise you this. Not because I'm so trustworthy that everything I promise you can. Yeah, it's not because of me. But because of who Jesus is. If you go to Jesus, your faith will make you well. It might not take away the sickness that you have. I have to say that in this culture, in this world today. You may finish your life with the sickness that you carry today. That's okay. I look around the room and many of us have something wrong with our body that we're probably going to have that same thing wrong with our body until the day that we're done with this body, and that is that we wear glasses. I mean, can God take our vision and put it right back to like it was when we were, you know, just learning to see and it was perfect then? Sure he can. Have I asked him, Lord, will you take my glasses from me and make me be able to see good? Sure I have, and many of you have. He hadn't done that. It's not because I don't have faith. It's just that God knows he needs to cover up some of his face a little bit, and glasses do that. But this is the truth. The important thing. The thing that matters is that my soul was sick unto death with sin. And I went to Jesus. And I saw him, and maybe I wasn't real far off because I was pretty young. And maybe you were a little further off because you were older and kind of deeper into the whatever. But the same thing is we hollered at Jesus, have mercy on us. We're sinners. Saves us. Have you been to Jesus? Is that the only important thing? It's the only real important thing. I mean, there are other things important, but that's the importantest. It's the mostest importantest. Est. Have you been to Jesus? If not, today I ask you, would you come to Jesus? Would you say, I'm afar off, but I know you can hear me. Have mercy on me. I want to come to you and continue to return to him. Every day you come to him, thank you, Father, for this. And I give you praise and glory and honor for this because you're so good. You're so worthy. And yeah, I'm still going to have to go to the priest. And yeah, I'm still going to have to do the law things. And yeah, I'm still... But I've been to Jesus for the one thing that matters. And everything else comes into play. At a time of the year when people feel extra lonely sometimes, at a time of the year when it's hard sometimes to figure out what to do because we want to do more for people than maybe we're able to do for them, at a time of the year when people are asking for more. Let's be sure that we never fail. That when people see us from afar off, they don't just see us in our unworthiness and all of that. Let them see what Jesus can do in a life that will come back and fall at his feet and give him glory. And today, if your life needs to do a little bit of change and encourage, especially even as we come to our invitation time in just a moment, to spend some time in prayer and say, God, help me to be that one who from afar off people can tell that I've been with Jesus. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? No one's looking around. Each one's looking within except our musicians who are making their way to help us with some music. We come to the moment of invitation when you're asked to respond to what you've heard and seen and done today. You've been to Sunday school talking about giving glory to the Lord. And here we've talked about one man out of 10 who came back to give glory to the Lord. And we've shared that. And maybe today you need to give your glory to the Lord. Be sure it's to him. As we go into Thanksgiving Day and to get into the worship of the time when Jesus came, maybe you need to be sure that you're worshiping him like you should. I encourage you during this time to pray. Maybe you need to come. Maybe today you need to be saved. Won't you give your heart to Jesus today? Well, Father, I pray now that in the moments that we share in this invitation time, I pray, God, that those who are in this room would know that they can come to you. Those that need a refreshing of that would do so even in these moments. Father, we give you praise and offer you glory for who you are, what you do. Help us to respond. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Today you need to respond. Would you come right now while we stand? Thanks once again for joining us here at Second Baptist Church. It's our privilege to come into your place today and to share some worship with you. We'd rather you be right here with us in the house, and we'd love it if you'd come. And listen, if God's spoken to you as we're gearing up for Thanksgiving today and moving in that direction, and you need some help with next steps and you want to talk about that, use the contact information on this forum. We'll be glad to get back with you as quickly as we can. We want to visit with you about your relationship with the Lord and about coming to Second Baptist Church. We hope you do. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody, and God bless.